Good morning. In today's class, let's start about the high pass, band pass and band reject filters. In the previous class, we discussed about low pass filters, both first order and second order. We derived the expression, we derived the frequency response, and we analyzed why a low pass filter gives this kind of frequency response. And we also showed that for a first order low pass filter, this roll off rate, the slope at which the gain falls off after the cutoff frequency, is 20 decibels per decade or minus 20 decibels per decade because it is decreasing. And for a second order low pass filter, the roll off rate is much higher, it becomes minus 40 decibels per decade because we have the S square term in the denominator of the transfer function. We derived this transfer function V naught by Vin, and because of this, it would be a two pole filter. There would be two poles, and after the cutoff frequency, the gain decreases rapidly at the rate of 40 decibels per decade. And we consider negative sign mainly because it is a decreasing gain. And we also discussed this fact that for a Butterworth filter, remember, for a Butterworth approximation, you have to have the flattest response. Remember, we considered having the most flattest response like this in the Butterworth approximation without any ripples. If this should be the case, then this damping factor zeta should be 0.707. Okay. So, in that case, we showed the second term in the denominator, which reduces to the value 3 minus AF into S by RC. We know 1 by RC stands for omega. So, leaving that, 3 minus AF becomes equal to 2 zeta. Usually, remember the standard transfer function, we write it as S square plus 2 zeta omega n into S plus omega n square. This is what we should have in the denominator. Now, omega n into S here, 1 by RC here represents omega n and S is there. So, 3 minus AF should be equated to 2 zeta. And when I substitute this zeta value as 0.707, I'll get AF to remain at 1.586. So, please remember, for a second order Butterworth response, it is compulsory that the gain of the non-inverting amplifier, which we are going to use in the filter, should definitely be 1.586 or 1.6 approximately. Now, we did some numericals also on this. So, with this background, let's move on to the discussion of high pass, band pass and band reject filters. So, the outcomes of this session, at the end of this session, you will be able to understand what are high pass, and band reject filters, and you will be able to analyze them, find out their transfer function V naught by Vin, and you will also be able to find the frequency response, how the frequency response looks. Then we will also find the cutoff frequencies from the frequency response and bandwidth. Remember, band pass and band reject will have a pair of cutoff frequencies or two cutoff frequencies, whereas high pass will have one single cutoff frequency, the lower cutoff frequency. So, first we'll move on to high pass. The question that can be asked would be something in this form. Explain the working of a first, second order high pass Butterworth filter with a neat circuit diagram and frequency response. Write the relevant design equations. Now, as I was telling you the other day, a first order Butterworth high pass filter is exactly similar to that of the first order low pass Butterworth filter. The only change will be in R and C values, which we have included at the input side of op-amp 741. Remember, we had R as the series element and C as the parallel element in the low pass filter. whereas in the high pass filter it is reversed. So C capacitor would be the series element and R would be the parallel element. As usual, this whole thing is a non-inverting amplifier, the same what we used for low pass filter, and this is a load resistance RL. Output will be measured across the load resistance, and the input signal is connected here, Vin or Vi, whatever you want you can call. We know the general values. As usual, for a non-inverting amplifier, the gain with feedback will be 1 plus RF by R1, and we know the reactance of a capacitor is given as 1 by 2 pi FC. So it is inversely proportional to frequency. The lower the frequency, the higher the capacitive reactance. Okay, we know all this, and we haven't considered J in this. We take J externally in the equation. Yes. So our first job is to find what is the voltage V1 across this resistor R. So this is the resistor which is connected as input to the non-inverting terminal. So if I find the voltage across this resistor, I'll be able to find the final output voltage as V1 into 1 plus RF by R1. So finding V1, we know I can use the voltage divider rule. Vin gets divided across the capacitor and this resistor. So what would be the equation? R into Vin divided by R plus XC or R minus J times XC. Remember, whenever I take XC, the reactance, I had shown you this, it will be 1 by J omega C, or if you want to, I'll just call this X. So if I write XC as 1 by omega C as shown here, omega is 2 pi F, then the capacitive reactance can be written as, if I take this J to the numerator, minus J into XC. That's why we have R minus J into XC here. And that would be the total impedance across this input generator Vin. Therefore, V1 is equal to R, just simplifying this, divided by R plus, for XC we are substituting 1 by 2 pi FC, and we have taken J in the denominator, that's why this plus sign. Okay, so I told you, you should know the various ways of writing this capacitive reactance. So just simplifying this, what we do now is only mathematical manipulations to arrive at the final expression correctly. So V1 can also be written as Vin into what? If I take this J 2 pi FC as the common factor in the denominator, it will also get multiplied with the numerator. So it will become Vin into J 2 pi FC into R. So J 2 pi FRC. Similarly, in the denominator, the first term will become J 2 pi FRC plus 1. So this would be the expression for V1. Once I know what is the voltage at the non-inverting input, the final output voltage can be determined as 1 plus RF by R1 into that input voltage V1. So multiply this 1 plus RF by R1 into V1. This V1 value we are substituting, and I know I can call 1 plus RF by R1 as AF. So we have just written it as AF into J2 pi FRC divided by 1 plus J2 pi FRC. Naturally, if I am finding the magnitude of this function would be what? The numerator, I'll remove the J term because I'm finding only the magnitude, and in the denominator it will be root of A square plus B square. If it is in the form A plus IB, the magnitude would be root of A square plus B square. So A here is 1, B is 2 pi FRC. So root of 1 square plus 2 pi FRC the whole square. This will give me the magnitude of the transfer function V0 by Vin. Okay. So now what happens at the cutoff frequency? When I say at the cutoff frequency, the meaning of this is when the frequency value f is equal to fl or fc, I can call it as. The cutoff frequency can be named as critical frequency also, we know. Or in case of high pass filters, it is the lower cutoff frequency, because we start with the minimum, we increase and we remain constant. So it would represent the lower cutoff frequency, after which the filter passes the input signal frequencies continuously. Before that cutoff value, it is going to attenuate the signals. After the cutoff value, it will pass the signals. Okay. So what will happen at that value? You just have to substitute f is equal to fc, or before that, we know what is, how do we define the cutoff frequency? I know I'll define this cutoff frequency fl as 1 by 2 pi rc. Same value, same definition we got for fh also. Low pass filter, we called the cutoff frequency as fh and it was 1 by 2 pi rc. Here it is again 1 by 2 pi rc. So what will happen to the equation when you substitute that? The above equation becomes af into jf by fl. You see, here I have 2 pi frc. So this 2 pi rc, I'll write it as 1 by fl. Yes or no? When fl is 1 by 2 pi rc, wherever I have 2 pi rc here, this 2 pi rc can be written as what? 1 by fl here as well as in the denominator. That's what we have done here. So you will get the transfer function as af into jf by fl divided by 1 plus jf by fl, okay, where fl represents the lower cutoff frequency. Therefore, where are we trying to find the magnitude? So the magnitude function of this would be af into f by fl, remove the j term, divided by root of a square plus b square, 1 square plus f by fl the whole square. So what happens at f is equal to fl? As we said, at f is equal to fl, the magnitude here, at f is equal to fl, this value becomes what? Af into f by fl. This f by fl is 1 now, right? This value is 1 divided by root of 1 plus 1. So this factor turns out to be 1 by root 2 at the frequency being equal to the lower cutoff frequency. And if I try to find it in decibels, 20 log 1 by root 2 is minus 3 dB. We know that already. We have already found 20 log 1 by root 2 is minus 3 dB. So from the highest value of gain, or from the passband gain, you come down by 3 decibels and you mark the frequency point. So that frequency point represents the lower cutoff frequency or the critical frequency of a high pass filter. And its value is determined by the R and C which we connect in the circuit. It's given as 1 by 2 pi RC. Okay. So please remember all this. And as you can see, what will happen to the bandwidth of this high pass filter? What would be the bandwidth of this high pass filter? It will start at this lower cutoff or critical frequency, and it can go on to remain constant until the maximum frequency allowed by the amplifier. Remember, every amplifier will have a slew rate, especially op-amp. So that slewing rate will put a limit on the highest frequency component that will be passed on by the amplifier properly. So that puts a limit here for the bandwidth. Otherwise, we can say ideally it should go on up to infinity. Once it starts passing frequencies, this high pass filter is supposed to pass on all the frequencies until infinity. So ideally speaking, bandwidth would be infinity, but practically a limit is put on the highest frequency due to slew rate of the op-amp, and that highest frequency will minus this FL will give you the bandwidth. So whatever is the highest frequency of operation we are using in the device, that minus this FL will give us the bandwidth of this filter. And one more thing which you should remember, this is a first order filter. It has just one S term in the denominator, as you can see here. Okay, the S term here, or j omega c, that term is S is equal to j omega c. So we have a single pole transfer function. Hence, the gain of this can be anything as determined by the designer. So I can keep the gain as 2, I can keep the gain as 1, 3, whatever we want. But when we move on to second order filter, the gain becomes fixed. Anyway, before passing on to the second order high pass filter, let's try to solve one numerical. Design a first order high pass filter to have a cutoff frequency of 1 kilohertz with a pass band gain of 2. So remember, what is the expression for cutoff frequency? The expression is 1 by 2 pi RC. And what is the expression for the passband gain? We know it is 1 plus RF by R1. So we have the expression for cutoff frequency and passband gain known. So what do? As usual, you always try to assume C less than 1 microfarad. Let us choose C as 0.01 microfarad as shown here. Okay, we are assuming C as 0.01 microfarad, and I will substitute the value of FL and C in this expression, so you will be able to find the resistance. The value of resistance is, turns out to be 15.9 kilo ohms. Now, the nearest available approximation is 15K. Either you use 15K or you can use 15K plus 820 ohms, which will also be available in the lab. Next, to design for the non-inverting amplifier resistances R1 and RF, we know that the gain is defined as 1 plus RF by R1, and we have to design for a gain of 2. So use R1. You will get RF by R1 is 2 minus 1. Yes or no? RF by R1 is 1. 2, this is 2 and this is 1. So RF is equal to R1. You can choose any value. Let's choose 10K. Done. We are done with the design. And if it is asked for 5 marks or more, you have to write the circuit also. I think the first order Butterworth high pass filter is clear. If you have any doubts, you can always interrupt and ask. If you don't have anything, we'll move on to second order Butterworth high pass filter. So you can expect the circuit. It is same as second order Butterworth low pass filter. Only thing is the positions of R2C2 and R3C3 have been interchanged in this. There you had R2 and R3 as series elements and C2 and C3 as the parallel. Here you have it as reverse. And as usual, R2 other end is connected to V0. That is to get the correct Butterworth second order response. And non-inverting amplifier as before with RF and R1 connected, the load resistor. So you can expect the frequency response to look something like this. What do you notice as the change between the previous and this? This roll-off rate, can you see it is increasing at a quicker rate here? What is the roll-off for first order filter? You see, for the first order filter, the roll-off or the slope of this, if I try to find the slope of this region, it would show a change of plus 20 decibels, an increase by 20 decibels for one decade of frequencies. Remember, one decade is change in frequency by a factor of 10. We have discussed all that. Okay. So this roll-off rate is 20 decibels per decade. It is much slower rise when compared to our second order filter, where the increase in the gain is much quicker. It is double. The slope of this would be plus 40 decibels per decade. Okay. As usual, the stop band is here. This changing region is the transition band, and the region where the signals are passed with high gain is the pass band. Okay. So we know AF is 1 plus RF by R1, as in the previous case also. What will happen to the expression? Proceeding in the same manner as we did for low pass. Remember how we did for low pass? We considered only this part of the circuit, right? And we found this voltage V1. V1 is the voltage at this point. And to do that, we considered the currents I1, I2. We can write the KCL at node A. We considered node A. We wrote the KCL at node A. Then we simplified it. And we were able to show that the expression for V0 by Vin would be something like this. Here also, if you are interested in deriving, you can proceed in the same manner. You will get the answer. In the notes, I will give. But actually, it is not needed for you to remember the derivation for examination purpose, if at all they hold an examination later. So here, the equation comes to this standard form again of a second order system. It is S square divided by S square plus R2C3 plus R2C2 plus R3C3 minus R3C3 AF into S divided by R2, R3, C2, C3. So you will have this as the standard expression. If you remember, we got a similar expression for the second order low pass. Now, what would be the magnitude of this gain? Remember, I can substitute 1 by R2, C2, R3, C3 as FL square. So remember, let FL square be 1 by R2, R3, C2, C3. So what would be the value of, or rather than FL square, it should be omega L square. This is omega L square. Omega L is 2 pi FL. This is 2 pi FL the whole square. If I am interested in FL, I will get it as 1 by 2 pi into root of R2, C2, R3, C3. The same standard equation which we got for low pass filter also. So it doesn't change. And you see the magnitude of this transfer function will also be AF divided by root of 1 plus FL by F. What is the change between this magnitude and low pass filter magnitude? There you had F by FH. Instead of this, you had F by FH whole to the power of 4 for a low pass filter. Whereas for a high pass filter, the cutoff frequency will be in the numerator and the variable frequency in the denominator. If you remember that change, it is more than sufficient. And deriving this is also very simple. You start by applying KCL to this node and go on substituting and simplifying the equations. You will easily end up with this final equation. So let's consider one problem on second order high pass Butterworth filter. Design a second order high pass filter to have a cutoff frequency of 5 kilohertz. We know, remember, for a second order Butterworth response, it is important to have gain as 1.586. Correct? So please remember this. As soon as we say second order, the gain of the amplifier should be 1.586, mainly because of the damping factor, which becomes 0.707 for a flat response. To get a response which is very flat in the pass band without any ripples, I should have damping factor as 0.707, and 3 minus AF, where AF is the gain of the amplifier, is 2 times zeta or 2 times 0.707. So we got AF as 1.586. Don't forget that. Please remember. Okay, let us design this filter. So we'll assume two capacitors to be equal, C2 equal to C3. Let it be 0.01 microfarad. Or if you want, you can take 0.0047, like how we took it in low pass. Anything, choose it to be less than 1 micro. Preferably in 0.0 something micro would be good, because it will give you a better value for resistance. If I take it as 0.1, it's not wrong, but your resistance value becomes much smaller. That may cause some loading effect. Okay, to avoid that loading effect and to get a good value of resistor, choose in the range 0.0 something practically. Now we know that what FL is equal to 1 by 2 pi R2 C2 R3 C3. Here we have chosen C2 equal to C3, therefore R2 equal to R3, let's say it is equal to R. FL is given as 5 kilohertz, therefore you can find R2 R3, which is R, as 1 by 2 pi FL into C. Correct. This is a square root, and when I consider these values to be equal, it will be, the square root gets removed, because I'll have R square into C square, and when I take it out, it will be RC. If you substitute this and check out, you'll be able to find the value of R. 2 pi into FL is 5K. Can anybody calculate and tell me the answer? 0.01 micro. What is the value of R? Simultaneously, we know for a second order filter, Butterworth filter, AF, which is 1 plus RF by R1, should be 1.586. Even if they don't give you this hint, you should know that always. Therefore, what is the value of RF by R1? RF by R1 will be 0.586, or let R1 be 10K, then RF will be 5.86 kilo ohm. If R1 is 10K, RF will be 5.86 kilo ohm. If you want a different value, choose a higher value for R1, you will get RF to be much higher. Anybody can tell me what is the value of this R? Anybody calculated? Okay, if not, you do it at home. With this, I think we can move on to the basics of band pass and band reject filters. Okay, until now we spoke about the two basic forms, that is low pass and high pass filters. Now let's move on to band pass and band reject filters. Here we are normally interested in studying the second order band pass and band reject, but there is one classification which I told we should remember, that is the bandwidth, whether you need a narrow bandwidth or wide bandwidth. So if you want the bandwidth to be very small, then it is a narrow band pass or band reject filter. If it is to be wider, then it is a wide band pass or band reject. Generally, the quality factor is a measure of this bandwidth. So please remember, the band pass and band reject filters can be under two categories, wide and narrow. As it is wide bandwidth and narrow bandwidth, surely. A wide band pass filter will have Q less than 1. The quality factor which is defined as center frequency divided by bandwidth of the filter. This will be less than 1 for a wide band pass. Why? The bandwidth will be higher, the center frequency will be smaller. So you can clearly expect this quality factor, which is a measure of the selectivity of the filter, how highly selective a given filter is. See, if it is something like this, it is highly selective. Look at the way the bandwidth is, very narrow bandwidth. It is a highly selective filter. So its quality factor will be what? For a highly selective filter, the quality factor will be high. So the quality factor should be very high if it is going to have very narrow bandwidth. Remember that. So the selectivity of a filter depends on its quality factor, which is defined as the ratio of center frequency divided by bandwidth. And it will be less than 1 for a wide band filter. Whether it is a wide band pass or wide band reject, this Q will be less than 1. Whereas for a narrow band filter, Q should always be greater than 1. If I want a filter to select a single frequency like this, if you want it to be very highly selective, you can expect Q to be somewhere in thousands. It can be 3000, 4000, 10,000. The higher the Q, the smaller the bandwidth, and you can make a filter select even a single frequency if required. That is possible with very high quality factor. And we have something known as surface acoustic wave filters, SAW, SAW filters, which are designed for high stability when we need to go for high quality factor. All this we will use in communication. Filters are commonly used in communication systems because whenever I need to transmit a signal, I need to send in a particular bandwidth, and whenever I need to receive, remember there are thousands of signals available. Your mobile should tune in only to the particular frequency in which you are receiving the call or whichever website you are browsing, so on. So it should use filters to select whichever frequency band you are trying to communicate with. Okay. So this is about the classification. And as you can see, the frequency response of a band pass filter, it has two stop bands and one pass band. It rejects the input signal at low and high frequencies and allows them to pass through only in a given range of frequencies or a given band of frequencies. We determine the lower frequency as F1, the higher as F2, the center frequency as F0. So the bandwidth of this filter would be F2 minus F1. Similarly, a band reject filter, also known as the notch filter, the band reject filter frequency response is exactly opposite that of band pass. Two pass bands and one stop band. It passes the signal at all frequencies except that given band of frequencies or the bandwidth. So between F1 and F2, it will attenuate the signal, but it will pass on the signal at all other frequencies. So bandwidth, as I told you, and how do we determine the center frequency practically? Usually it is chosen as root of F1 into F2. F1 is the lower cutoff, F2 is the higher cutoff. So the center frequency is determined as root of F1 into F2. As I have already defined, the quality factor, which is a figure of merit of any band pass or band reject filter. This Q comes into effect only in band pass or band reject. I don't have a Q for low pass or high pass, right? Because there is nothing like center frequency and bandwidth there. But here, the selectivity measure can be obtained by using this quality factor. Whether a filter should select only a small range of frequencies or whether it can select a large bandwidth of frequencies. Lesser the Q, larger the bandwidth. Okay. So the band pass filter, let's see. It has a pass band between frequencies F1 and F2, also called as FL and FH. Okay, and the bandwidth depends on the quality factor. The quality factor, also known as figure of merit, it's a measure of selectivity. Higher the Q, narrower the bandwidth. If I try to substitute in the expression for Q, I'll have numerator as F0 or FC, center frequency. The bandwidth is FH minus FL. And FC is determined as root of FH into FL. That is root of FH into FL. And FH is the higher cutoff, FL is the lower cutoff. So Q is greater than 10 if we have a narrow bandpass filter. And there will be multiple feedback circuits. We'll see the actual circuit of the filter. For wideband, usually we prefer Q less than 1, but Q less than 10 is also permitted. So if I have Q as 2, 3, 5, anything, even then it will give us a wide bandwidth only. Okay. So usually how do we design a wide bandpass filter? It's very easy. You just cascade a high pass and a low pass filter. As simple as this. You first use a high pass filter, second order high pass filter, which we have just now designed. Give your input signal there. So what will happen? The output signal will start passing on the complete signal after some particular frequency, that is FL. Now this signal is given as input to a low pass filter, which is also second order. Now if I design this LPF to have a proper cutoff frequency, the input signal at low frequencies, whatever I had, it should be passed on as it is. So whatever signal I have, it will pass it on at low frequencies. But after some time, it should attenuate, and that frequency is given by FH. So it is low pass filter is showing its action after FH. Hence, I am easily getting the band pass filter response using a cascade of high pass and low pass as shown. Are you able to follow? So it's very simple and easy to obtain a band pass response by simply connecting high pass filter first and then the low pass filter to limit both low and higher cutoff frequencies. So usually it should be connected in this order only, because interchanging the order very often may result in certain loss of signals at low frequencies. If I have low pass first and then high pass, there may be a certain loss of signals happening at low frequencies. So we prefer having high pass first and then the low pass, so that the bandwidth is maintained properly and the gain is maintained properly. And one thing you should always remember, the cutoff frequency of this filter should what? Always be greater than the cutoff frequency of the high pass. So let's continue. This is the simplest way of designing a wide bandpass filter. So a wide bandpass filter can be formed by cascading high pass and low pass sections. Here, wide bandpass filter is designed where each of the filters, the low pass and high pass, is designed for a roll off rate of plus or minus 20 decibels per decade if we are using first order. For second order, we'll have to design both for plus or minus 40 dB per decade. So you can see the circuit of a first order wide bandpass filter. You see the first order low pass filter with C in series and R in shunt, the non-inverting amplifier. Output of, so this is a high pass filter, first order high pass filter. It's connected, cascaded, it's given as input. Output of this filter is given as input to the first order low pass filter, where I have R dash as the series element and C dash as the shunt element. Okay. So the final output will be having the bandpass response. And you see what will happen to the parameters. The low pass filter has higher cutoff frequency. Remember, the low pass, it should pass the signals at low and cut off after a certain frequency. So we always determine the higher cutoff frequency, which will be 1 by 2 pi R dash C dash, the corresponding resistor and capacitor of the low pass section. And its transfer function will be given as A2, or let's say AF2, where AF2 is 1 plus RF dash by R1 dash. Usually we can have both to have the same gain. RF R1 can be common for both the circuits. Anyway, here we've shown it to be slightly different. So 1 plus RF dash by R1 dash. Okay. And you can also see that the magnitude of this transfer function will be root of 1 plus F by FH whole square, as we designed for the high pass, low pass filter. For high pass, it will be same thing. FL will be 1 by 2 pi RC. Here the resistors and capacitors are R and C. And the transfer function, we are just recalling what we have already derived in the previous sections. AF1, I'll call, is 1 plus RF by R1, the gain of the first amplifier, okay? So AF1 into F by FL divided by root of 1 plus F by FL, the whole square. And now the combined gain would be the product of the individual gains, as you can see. For the band pass filter, since we are just cascading output of high pass as input to low pass, it will be AF1 into AF2 into F by FL, as we have F by FL in the numerator for high pass filter transfer function. And the denominators are root of 1 plus F by FH whole square into 1 plus F by FL whole square. And as you can see, the frequency response will be addition of high pass and low pass response. And since it is first order, we have a single RC circuit. So the roll off rate on both the increasing and decreasing ends, the high pass and low pass ends, is plus 20 and minus 20 decibels per decade. Okay. And we have shown this as the maximum gain AF. And this point is in decibels, it will be minus 3 dB. If I take the actual value, it will be AF by root 2, as we have already determined. It is the value of gain at F is equal to FH or F is equal to FL. So this value turns out to be 0.707 times AF or AF by root 2. Okay, I think there is no confusion there. A very simple circuit. Similarly, I can have second order by cascading the second order high pass and the second order low pass. Only change here is, you should remember, the gain for a second order filter will remain 1.586 as always. Now, how do we design a narrow bandpass filter? This is interesting. You see, a narrow bandpass filter can be designed as shown in this circuit below. You have two resistors R1 and R2. Along with a feedback resistor R3. So three resistors in this circuit. If you leave out the load resistance, RL is not important. Even if I don't connect, it doesn't matter. And two capacitors. Unless I have two capacitors, it's not possible for me to get S square term in the denominator. Second order, if I want, I need S square term. Anyway, so C1 and C2 are two capacitors. So this gives a very narrow bandwidth in its frequency response. So this bandwidth FH minus FL will be very, very small, as you can observe. Okay. So the design equation for this filter, we don't have the derivation, so you have to remember these things. The gain at the center frequency for this circuit will be obtained as R3 by 2 times R1. So R3 divided by 2 R1 would be the gain at center frequency. Remember this. The design equations would be, R1 is given by quality factor divided by 2 pi FC into C into AF. Okay. fc is the center frequency, as you remember, and for a band pass filter, remember that center frequency is root of fl into fh. Please remember that. And r2 is given by 2 pi fcc into 2 q square minus af. So you can clearly see this quality factor is a part of finding both the resistors R1, R2, and also the resistor R3. You can see R3 is given by Q by pi Fc into C. And finally, to change the central frequency with the same bandwidth and the feedback gain, we have to have R2 dash to be R2 into Fc by Fc dash. If you want to change the center frequency from Fc to Fc dash, remember that ratio of R2 dash to R2 to be maintained. R2 here, and I'll change it to another value R2 dash if I want to change the center frequency from Fc to Fc dash. So this is an expression to change the center frequency, but you can retain it also. So all you have to do here is remember the circuit, remember the transfer function equations. Okay, we are not even writing the transfer function anyway, good enough. And the frequency response and bandwidth. So one numerical, design a bandpass filter to have FL 200 Hz and FH 1 kHz. The passband gain should be 4. So it's a first order bandpass filter because the passband gain can be anything. Draw the frequency response and calculate the value of Q. So to design the low pass filter, you use FH. So how do you find the low pass filter? In the low pass filter, FH is 1 by 2 pi R dash into C dash. As usual, assume the capacitor. Let C dash be 0.01 microfarad. So you can find R dash. Here FH is 1K. Therefore, you have to find R dash is 1 by 2 pi into 1K into C, which is 0.01 micro. So you will be designing the low pass filter. For high pass filter, you should use FL, which is 200 Hz, which is 1 by 2 pi RC. Again, let C be, if you want, you can take the same C. If not, you can take a different 0.0047 micro. Then, if at all you take the same C, you will get the same R. R is equal to R dash, right? If you take a different C, you will get R as 1 by 2 pi. You will get a different value because the frequency is different. Even if you take the same C, you will get a different value. 1 by 2 pi into 200 into C value 0.0047. So the value of R and R dash are different. C and C dash are different. Even if you choose the same values for R, R dash and C, C dash, you will, same values for C and C dash, you will get R dash different from R, mainly because the frequencies are different. The lower cutoff frequency will be less than higher cutoff. Because of that, you will get two different resistance values. So it is preferable to use two different capacitor values also. So next is a problem of design for a narrow bandpass filter. The narrow bandpass filter should be designed for a center frequency of 1 kHz. Okay, Q, the quality factor is 3 and the gain is 10. So then you are asked to change the frequency from 1.5 or from 1 to 1.5, keeping AF and bandwidth to remain the same. We already saw what is the equation for that. So for such a problem, how do you design? You have to first consider, we know for changing the frequency, R2 dash is determined as R2 into Fc by Fc dash, the whole square. And substitute Fc and Fc dash here. Fc is 1K, Fc dash is 1.5K. So when you substitute, and when you substitute R2, you will be able to find R2 dash. And how do you find R2? You have to choose capacitors C1, C2, 0.01 microfarad. Then you can find R2. We have the equations here. R2 based on Q and based on C value and AF, you will be able to find it. AF is given as 4. AF represents the passband gain, which is 4. So if you substitute in these equations, you will be able to do it. We'll take it a little detailed here. You can see, design a wide band. This is designing of a wide band pass filter. This we have already done. I was telling you here, this example, the same example is explained in detail here. We have chosen C dash as 0.01 microfarad. You will get R dash as 15.9K. This is for low pass filter. And in the high pass filter, you have taken C as 0.05. You are getting R as 15.9K. This is high pass filter. Since the passband gain is 4, the gain of both low pass and high pass sections should be what? 4 by 2, because it is AF1 into AF2. The overall gain is product of the individual gains of low pass and high pass. So you can take this as RF by R2 is equal to RF by R1. Okay, which is, it will give you a result of 2 is equal to 1 plus RF by R1. So you will get RF and R1 to be equal. You can choose 10K, and you can now find what would be the quality factor of this circuit. You will see the center frequency is root of FL into FH. So 1K into 200 Hertz, square root of that will turn out to be 447.2 Hertz. And the bandwidth is what? 1 kilohertz minus 200 hertz. This should be 1000. So 1000 minus 200, which is 800. So I'll almost get half, 0.5, which is surely much less than 10, which is what is required for a wide bandpass filter. So remember, this wide bandpass filter is the cascade of high pass and low pass filters. Okay. Whereas the narrow one is different. The narrow bandpass filter is something like this. Okay. The problem on narrow bandpass filter, which we have written here, I have solved it completely. Hope you can see it. So just have a look how we do it. I was explaining it to you. Here we are going in detail about that. Choose the two capacitors. This is a simple way of doing it. Let it be 0.01 microfarad. Then R1 would be what? Q divided by 2 pi into the frequency FC, 1 kilohertz into the capacitance value. So you're getting this. R1 turns out to be 4.77. I told you, you should use all the equations. R2 is again Q divided by 2 pi FC into C2 into 2 Q square minus N. So you'll get that as 5.97 kilo ohm. R3 is again Q by pi into FC into C. Pi FCC, we have substituted. FC is 1K. C is 0.01, which means 10 power minus 8 farad. Okay. So 95.5K we are getting. Once you have all the three resistors, now you substitute in the formula to get new cutoff frequency or new center frequency, we should call. So the new center frequency FC, which has to be 1.5K, can be obtained if I change R2 to R2 dash, and R2 dash is determined as R2 into FC by FC dash. FC was 1 kilohertz. FC dash is 1.5K. When you substitute and square it, you will get what should be the new value of R2 dash. R2 was 5.97. R2 dash should now change to 2.65 to get center frequency of 1.5K. So this is how we solve both the problems. Let me discuss this term, the change in resistance R2, so that we are able to change the center frequency without changing the gain or bandwidth. So without making any change in the gain of the amplifier or bandwidth of the amplifier, for a narrow bandpass filter, it is possible for us to change its center frequency just by changing one resistance from R2 to R2 dash. This concept is known as frequency scaling. Okay, so please remember, this concept is called frequency scaling. I think we can't discuss about band reject in this class, so let's stop here. So what did we study in this session? We understood what are high pass, band pass and band reject filters. We analyzed them, we classified them as narrow and wide, and we said the quality, we defined the quality factor. We said quality factor is a measure of selectivity of the filter. The higher the quality factor, the more selective or the narrower the bandwidth. Okay, all that we discussed, it is given as F0 by bandwidth. And we also determined the cutoff frequencies and bandwidth of all these filters. I think band reject filters we can discuss in the next class.